Good morning, everyone. It is time for us to begin our worship service this morning. We'll start pre-worship with a few announcements. Want to welcome everyone, and if you're visiting with us, you're an honored guest. We're glad to have you with us. Good to see this many folks out today. There's quite a few folks that are staying home because of increased case numbers and the COVID that's been affecting all around the world. And so we want to keep those folks in mind. I'll mention them here in just a minute. Want to remind everyone of our mask policy here. The first three rows are for those who don't wear a mask or cannot wear a mask. It's I guess you can wear one in the first three rows if you want to, but you'll be sitting near someone who's not. And then from the fourth row back, we ask that people please wear a mask, and that will be helpful for all of us. We appreciate you doing that. Keep in mind the work of our missionaries, Valapi Malongani over in Zimbabwe. Continue to remember Brian Hall and his mission work down in Guyana, and Stephen Haley. Also Dave Harris, who hasn't been able to go anywhere this year, but he will be going somewhere sometime soon, right? Yes. And let's keep Jason Carter and the congregation down in Dry Ridge in our prayers as well. And speaking of that, one of our men here will be leading singing down there this evening. I believe it's Brett. Is that correct, Brett? Yes, he's shaking his head, yes. So we encourage anyone who can go down there and support the folks down at Grant County. They meet at 6 p.m. All right. Update on some folks here. Unfortunately, earlier this week, Bruce Scudder, who is Sherry Reynolds' father, tested positive for COVID. I don't have any more updates on that, but keep Bruce in your prayers, and also Dale and Sherry are at home this morning because they're going to quarantine for a while to make sure that they're okay. Ava Hudson has also tested positive for COVID down at Harding University, and she's in quarantine, so we want to keep her in our prayers. Hannah Lease has been battling mono. I think she's been getting some better, but continue to keep her in your prayers as well. The Griffin family, Crystal Myers' relatives, we announced them last week. We want to make sure that we keep them in our prayers, and they're hopefully getting better after having positive diagnosis of COVID. Bill Tuttle asked for prayers for his family. He had a death in the family, his sister-in-law. Then he also had a friend's wife who passed away from COVID. And his friend Perry Miller also now is positive as well. Keep Marge Tuttle in your prayers also. She's been monitored for a heart condition and waiting on test results. Hopefully those will come very soon and give some indication of what they can do for her. And Lois Westover, Sonny Pugh's mother and Jennifer's grandmother in hospice. We want to keep remembering her in our prayers as well. And then those that are staying home due to illness, we want to keep them, or due to the COVID and try not to be exposed. We want to keep Carl and Vicki Shreve in our prayers, Debbie and Pauline Vanderpool, Debbie Wrights and Pauline Vanderpool. Continue to keep Tootsie Reeves in your prayers as well. Frank and Chris and Judy, Dan and Carol Link, and Cheryl Piles. Please keep all of those folks in your prayers as well. Alan Womack, as we've been announcing, has been away for military training, but he does return home on the 29th, so we should be getting him back with us very soon. We're looking forward to that. A couple of upcoming events. This Wednesday evening, we're going to do Trunk or Treat out in the parking lot, hopefully with the weather permitting. So plan on that. That will be after Bible study on Wednesday. And then the planning meeting for the elders, deacons, and preachers is Saturday, November 11th, and that will be here at the building this year. Plans are due to the elders from the deacons by the 1st of November, so you have one more week. We appreciate you getting those in in for us so that we can have a productive session on that Saturday. All right. Those are all the announcements that I have for this morning. If you would, join me in a word of prayer as we begin our worship service together. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning and we are thankful for the opportunity that we have to be here today. And we pray, Father, that you would help us to uplift one another, encourage one another today as we worship you. And we pray that our worship to you is in spirit and in truth. We pray for those that we've mentioned here that are diagnosed with COVID and other illnesses, Father, and we just pray that you would reach your healing hand down upon them and help them, heal them so that they can be back to their normal lives and back here with us, Father. We pray for those that are away from us traveling and Alan on military duty. We just pray that you would keep all of them safe and in your care and bring them back home safely as well. Father, be with those that are staying home due to fear of the virus and not wanting to be exposed, Father, and we pray that you would help strengthen and encourage them as well. We pray that you would be with this nation, Father, and the nations around the world that are looking for the cure and the treatment, Father, that will end this pandemic, and we pray that that will happen soon, and we can get back to normal lives and be back to meeting together more often as we desire to do here at Point Pleasant. We pray for the upcoming election that those that are elected to serve this nation would do so in a way that would be pleasing to you, that would help this nation, Father, to continue to be a nation that can be blessed by you. We thank you, Father, for the blessings that you've given to us, and pray that we will use those blessings to your glory and your honor. Father, we at times sin and fall short, and we pray that you would forgive us, and we pray, Father, that you would help us strive each day to live in accordance with your will. But we know, Father, that we have the blood of Christ, and we are so thankful that he went to the cross so that our sins could be forgiven. We pray, Father, that you would forgive us. Father, go with us throughout this service. Help us as we sing these songs of praise to you and as we listen to your word being proclaimed. We pray for Dave this morning that you'll give him boldness. We pray that you would be with us, Father, as we gather around the table this morning in remembrance of the sacrifice that was made on our behalf. And we thank you, Father, for this avenue of prayer that we can bring these things before you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our first song this morning will be Whispering Hope.
Soft as the voice of an angel, breathing a lesson unheard, hope with a gentle persuasion whispers her comforting word. Sunshine tomorrow after the shower is gone. Whispering hope, oh, how welcome thy voice.
Before the lesson this morning, we'll sing Standing on the Promises. If you will, stand with me as we sing this song together. Standing on the promises.
Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let his praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God. Promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of doubt and fear assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises I cannot fall. Listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all in all, standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God.
Please be seated.
Loud and clear as Brett tries to turn me down. Good morning. It's good to see everybody. Glad to be here with you. I know we're missing several folks and we've got some visitors. We're glad you're here. Great to have this opportunity to worship together, to spend our time with the Lord today. And I pray that He is the focus and the center of all that we're doing. Our Sunday night series, we have two more Sunday nights left. Two more C's of contemplation. So if you are able to get on there, if you're able to join us on Sunday evenings, we try to start right around 6 o'clock. And we have two more of those devotionals left. They're not a full hour. They're usually about 20, 25 minutes, something like that. So just something for you to think about, something to challenge yourself with for the coming week. I was talking to Sunny before services, and we were talking about her mother, and I think it's important to keep their family in your prayers. This is a hard time with Lois as she's in hospice. I don't want to distract you too much from worshiping, but I want to make sure everybody else prays for you and your family. Those moments when you cherish as things can move on, that you pray for the family as they go through those times when they feel kind of helpless. So I know several of us have been through that in the last year. So our prayers are with you, and everybody in the family for that matter. So, lessons from a lame man. Acts chapters 3 and 4, if you have your Bible and you want to turn there, we'll spend most of our time in Acts chapters 3 and 4. We'll spend our time there thinking about this lame man. This is a person in the Bible that I often want to emulate, that I often want to live up to, that I often think about, okay, am I living the way that the lame man lived? And I want us to take a look at some of the attributes of this lame man. Jonathan has led some songs and will lead some songs. He asked me what my topic was, and I laid out the whole outline for him, and all of his songs are connected to my sermon, and I'm grateful for him doing that. So as we think about the lame man today, as we think about him and his example for us, as it's given to us in the inspired word of God, think about several different ways that he physically exhibited his faith. How he physically exhibited his faith, and then we're going to apply that to ourselves. So let's begin. Lessons from a lame man. Acts chapter 3, if you have your Bibles and you've got them turned there. I think first of all, it's thinking about his eyes. His eyes. Acts chapter 3, beginning with those opening five or six verses here, let's read those together if we will, please. It says, "Now Peter and John went up together to the temple at the hour of prayer, the ninth hour. And a certain man, lame from his mother's womb, was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of those who entered the temple, who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked for alms, and fixing his eyes on them with John, Peter said, 'Look at us.' So he gave them his attention, expecting to receive something from them. Then Peter said, 'Silver and gold I do not have, but what I do have, I give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk.'" You see, when they looked at that lame man, they said, "We need you to pay attention. We need your eyes. We need you to focus. We need you to be looking directly at us as we're speaking." And I think for us, it's about focus. For us, it's about, where are your eyes? Where are you looking? Where are you spending your time and your energy? Where is our focus? Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, it talks about the fact that we are to throw aside the weight of sin that so easily ensnares us, and that we're to run the race that is set before us, always keeping our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. Psalm 123, I thought it would all just kind of pop up there. Brett, you can just let, each time those bottom boxes come up, you can just build them all up. That's fine. I'd rather everybody have the scriptures, because sometimes I go too fast, and then you're like, "Hold on, I didn't get there yet." At least that's what my wife says to me. "Hold on, I didn't get there yet." Psalm 123, it talks similarly about, this is one of those songs of ascent. If you remember back a couple years ago when I did that sermon and we talked about those psalms that they said as they were going up the stairs into the temple and getting their right hearts and their minds right with God before they went into worship Him, this is one of those psalms. In Psalm 123, it says, "How are you? You know, what's your focus?" He says, "Unto you I lift up my eyes, O you who dwell in the heavens. Behold, as the eyes of servants look to the hands of their masters, as the eyes of a maid to the hand of her mistress, so our eyes look to the Lord, our God, until He has mercy on us. Have mercy on us, O God. Have mercy on us, for we are exceedingly filled with contempt. Our soul is exceedingly filled with the scorn of those who are at ease with the contempt of the proud." Our eyes need to be looking toward God, he says here in Psalm 123. The psalmist says, we need to be focused. Sometimes we're focused so heavily on the things going on around the world, even if it's within the church, we're focused on the things that distract us from the real reason we're here, and that's to worship God. That's to give God, the Creator, the glory and honor that He deserves. He says, what's your focus? Where are your eyes? Peter and John told the lame man. He said, look at me. He said, look at me. Where's your focus? The second thing that happened, as we go through, I love this graphic, as we go through this story, this event, this historical timeline for this lame man, right? Peter just says to him, I don't have silver and gold, but what I do have is for you, is Christ Jesus. He says, now get up and walk. And this man does more than walk. Let's read together. Acts chapter 3, verses 7 through 10. And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and his ankle bones received strength. So he, leaping up, stood and walked and entered the temple with them, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God. And then they knew that it was he who sat begging alms at the beautiful gate of the temple. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at what had happened to him. Sometimes amazing things happen in our lives. I believe that when we're saved, when we're baptized, it's an amazing moment in our lives. And sometimes I've seen people hop out of that water. I told y'all, I won one of the Vivos on Facebook. I mentioned this moment where my dad used to shave, and the cat would come in, and he would sit on the toilet and watch him every time he shaved. I don't know what the fascination was. But Mittens would sit there and watch him while he shaved. Well, one day, my dad forgot to put the toilet seat down, you know, and the cat leapt up to sit on the, and I don't think he ever touched bottom. Like, he was up as fast. You ever seen someone get baptized, and when they come up out of the water, they've got that excitement, right? This is what that man was feeling. This is what the lame man was. He was leaping and dancing and praising God, and sometimes we lose that. Sometimes that excitement, that joy that is in our hearts gets lost over time, gets bogged down, gets left behind. Let's look at some of these verses here together. I gave you several, but they're pretty quick. Romans chapter 6, verse 17, it talks about the heart, and it talks about the heart is where it all begins, right? But God be thanked that though you were slaves of sin, yet you obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine to which you were delivered. Right? It begins in the heart. It's because of belief that you obey. It's because of your heart changing. Your heart becomes just swelling with love for God, for what He did for you. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 22. We come over here to verse 22. It's these verses that all come together into the lettuce verses, right? They're all about lettuce. In verse 22, he says, let us draw near with a true heart in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Right? When that conversion happens and our heart is true and it has that full assurance of faith, there's joy. Our hearts have changed. They're full of love. That's why I go back to Psalm 32 and then the Psalms. Psalm 32, verse 11. He says, be glad in the Lord and rejoice, you righteous, and shout for joy, all you upright in heart. Psalm 33, 21 and 22. Just a page over, or the same page. He says, for our heart shall rejoice in Him because we have trusted in His holy name. Let your mercy, O Lord, be upon us just as we hope in you. And then lastly, over in Psalm 16, verses 8 through 11, finishing up that chapter, it says, I have set the Lord always before me, because He is at my right hand and I shall not be moved. Therefore my heart is glad and my glory rejoices. My flesh also will rest in hope. For you will not leave my soul in Sheol, nor will you allow your Holy One to see corruption. You will show me the path of life In your presence is fullness of joy, and at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. It's that joy. It's that joy that we experience when we get baptized because our hearts were pricked. Our hearts were made to feel guilty for the sin in our lives, right? When each of us came to that water, it was for a reason, because we felt the need for salvation. And when we came up out of that water, we were so filled with love and we were so filled with joy because, guess what? I'm saved. I'm saved. And the excitement, the joy, the happiness, where's it gone? I love this lame man's example. I pray we can live up to this lame man's example as he has focus, as he has joy in his heart. And thirdly, as we get into the next example in verse 11, as we think about his hands. Back over in Acts chapter 3. He's just been healed, right? There's no problem with his legs. He's leaping, he's jumping, he's praising, he's all over the place. Don't misunderstand the words in this next verse. In verse 11 of chapter 3, it says, "Now as the lame man who was healed held on to Peter and John, all the people ran together to them in the porch, which is called Solomon, greatly amazed." This lame man was not holding on because he was weak. This lame man was not holding on because he couldn't stand on his own. This lame man was holding on because he didn't want to let them go. He wanted to be as close to them and surrounded by them for as long as he could be, because he had that joy. He just wanted to keep that. He wanted to hold fast to that. What are we holding fast to? What are we grabbing hold of in our lives? I gave you some verses up here. Hebrews 3, 6. Hebrews chapter 3, verse 6, it says, "But Christ is as a son over his own house, whose house we are, if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm to the end." We have to hold fast that confidence. Are you confident? Are you confident in your faith? Are you confident in what you believe? Are you confident in your salvation, that you're going to heaven? You have to hold on to that. Look at Hebrews chapter 10, verse 23. We're back to the let us verses, right? Let us do this and let us do that. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 23. He says, "Let us hold fast the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who promised is faithful." What did you say right before you got baptized? You said what? "I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God." Are you holding on to that confession? Do people make you shy away from continuing to make that confession? How important is Jesus in your life right now? 1 Thessalonians 5:21. I'm moving around in verses all over the place real fast. I hope everybody's keeping up with me. It says to test all things, hold fast to what is good. Hold on to that which is good. And 1 Corinthians 15:2. Paul here, as he's writing to the church in Corinth, and he gives them the whole... We talk about the gospel, what the gospel is here in that beginning of 1 Corinthians 15. In verse 2, he says, "By which you also were saved, if you hold fast that word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain." What are you holding on to? What when you think about what you're grabbing hold of and what you're surrounding yourself with and what's... I think about that lame man, right? I told you, I love the example he gives us. The fact that he focused, the fact that he was so joyful, his heart was filled with joy and love. And then when he has the opportunity and he stops dancing and he stops just, he reaches up and he grabs hold of them because he never wants to let go. The chapter continues on. And in the... verses 12 through 26, Peter gives this great speech. A speech we're not going to spend time on because we don't want to be here for 2 hours. He gives this great speech, right? They're standing at the gate of the temple. It's the beautiful gate. It's the gate beautiful. So it's beautiful. There's been lots of different stories about what the gate looks like, but it doesn't matter for us right now because Peter gives this great speech, and then what happens after that great speech? Chapter 4, beginning in verse 1, it's a rough night. You see the picture on the right, the right-hand side of the screen shows a much different picture. It says, now as they spoke to the people, the priests, the captain of the temple, and the Sadducees came upon them, being greatly disturbed that they taught the people and preached in Jesus the resurrection from the dead. And they laid hands on them and put them in custody until the next day, for it was already evening. However, many of those who heard the word believed, and the number of men came to be about 5,000. And it came to pass on the next day that their rulers, elders, and scribes, as well as Annas the high priest, Caiaphas, John, and Alexander, and as many as were of the family of the high priest, were gathered together at Jerusalem. What a rough night. But understand who went to jail. This isn't just Peter and John going to jail. This is the lame man as well. The lame man went to jail as well. And in fact, in verses 8 through 12, I think it's 8 through 12, what's it say? Yeah, 5 through 12, excuse me. Peter stands up and gives a defense, another speech, although a little shorter. A defense of their stance for Jesus. And the last example I pull for us when I think about the lame man is him standing before the Sanhedrin with Peter and John. This is a painting of what the Sanhedrin looked like. You remember last week we talked about that servant of Elisha being intimidated by that commander standing outside their hut or wherever they lived and all the guard with him and the servants. I think about the lame man today. I think about having been in jail all night long, be it with Peter and John, but he's been in jail all night long and he gets up. And let's read in verses 13 and 14 of chapter 4. Now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated and untrained, they marveled and they reasoned that they had been with Jesus. And seeing the man who had been healed standing with them, they could say nothing against it. You see, I think about this lame man's feet, where he was standing, where he chose to plant himself firmly. We have to think about where we are where we stand in our lives when we take a stand in our lives, both figuratively and literally. Jonathan had a stand for standing on the promises. Completely appropriate. Have you ever had somebody make you sit for standing on the promises? Because it makes you think about what's the song saying? You need to stand firm upon the promises of God. It's not about whether or not you're on your feet. I love standing for that song. You did good. But does that make sense? Do you understand? It's not about whether or not you're upright for singing. It's about whether you realize what you're standing firmly upon, which is the promises that God made to each and every one of us. Look at some of these verses with me. It talks about standing fast. And we shall live in 1 Thessalonians 3:8. It talks about standing fast in the teachings that they were given, right? And it's not about the word because they didn't have the word. They had the Old Testament, but they didn't have the New Testament. They're saying stand fast in what you've been educated in, what the people around you have taught you. Stand fast in what you've been taught in your classes at church and the things that you've learned. But let Philippians chapter 1, verses 27 through 30. Read those with me, if you will. Philippians. There we go. Chapter 1, verses 27 through 30. It says, only let your conduct be worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent, I may hear of your affairs, that you stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel, and not in any way terrified by your adversaries, which is to them a proof of perdition, but to you of salvation, and that from God. For to you it has been granted on behalf of Christ not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for his sake, having the same conflict which you saw in me and now here is in me. He said, stand fast in one spirit, in one mind, striving together for the gospel. Stand fast together. Not just as a congregation, but as a church, as God's universal church, understanding that there are Christians out there in other buildings, understanding that there are Christians out there who aren't white, who aren't American, who aren't whatever you want to describe. We have to stand united in one spirit and in one faith and in one gospel. Stand firm. Where do you stand? And who are you standing with? What's so important to you that you lay aside the rest of the people? That you lay aside the faith, the love, the feelings of those that surround you? The lame man's story began in Acts chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. The lame man's story began without him having any control. Back in Acts chapter 3, read those opening two verses to me, with me. Not to me. It said, now Peter and John went up together to the temple at the hour of prayer, the ninth hour, and a certain lame man, lame from his mother's womb, was carried, whom they laid down daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask for alms from those who entered the temple. You know, to me, I think it's important to see that in order for the lame man to receive, to focus, to have the joy in his heart, someone had to get in there. Someone had to carry him. Someone had to bring him to the Lord. I think about Mark chapter 2, right? The lame man that they lowered down, the paralytic man that they lowered down through the roof. He could never have come to Jesus if it weren't for his friends. And as you think about the impact you have on other people's lives, as you think about where you're leaping and your praising of God will have an impact on others, it's because it'll allow you to bring other people to the gate so that they can see the power of God. We need to bring others to where God can impact their lives, where God can change them, where God can fill their hearts and prick their hearts and show them the love and joy that they can have. We need to bring others to the gate. Today, I pray that we can all remember to think about how we focus, that we can think about how we have joy in our lives for our Lord, that we can think about what we're holding on to, where we stand, and who we need to bring to the gate. When we think about filling our pews, and one day being able to use all of our pews, it's only because we'll show other people the joy that we have in our Lord. Today, I pray that as I say to you, look at me, that you'll hear the Lord's message, not my message. That the Lord doesn't offer you silver and gold, and he doesn't offer you healing from your physical infirmities, but that he offers you healing from your spiritual infirmities. That God offers you forgiveness. That God offers you salvation. And today you can spiritually stand on strong ankles and strong feet if you are in need of the healing from God. Today, if there is any way we can help you with your salvation, be it through baptism for the remission of your sins so that you can leap up out of that water with joy, or because you need prayers because you've forgotten your joy, or just because you're hurting so much, we implore you to come as we stand and sing.
Sit great in Lord to ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee. Take my voice and let me sing, always, only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from thee. Take my will. Take myself and I will be ever only all for thee.
Please be seated. As we prepare for the Lord's Supper this morning, we'll sing number 742, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross.
When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my richest gain meet. Oh,
The 2020 news cycle is certainly one of the darkest in recent memory. But if 2020 has taught us anything, it's to expect the unexpected. Perhaps that's why this story went viral, because the outcome was so unexpected. You see, in early July, buried beneath the headlines of raging wildfires and violent riots and partisan politics, between the reports of marauding murder hornets and mounting COVID case counts, came a rare glimmer of light. A simple yet compelling story of true love and self-sacrifice. You might have heard about it. On July 9th, in a quiet neighborhood of Cheyenne, Wyoming, 6-year-old Bridger Walker and his 4-year-old little sister Brielle were playing at a friend's house when they decided to take their play to the backyard. Well, the backyard was also occupied by a 1-year-old German Shepherd mix. And inexplicably, the dog charged beautiful Brielle. But just as the dog lunged, Bridger stepped in the gap. In his own words, Bridger said, "I stepped to the side in front of my sister so that the dog wouldn't get her. I kept moving so it couldn't get past." Young Bridger would pay a high price for his brave decision. The mauling he took for his sister was brutal. The pictures are horrific. It would take 2 hours and 90 stitches for the plastic surgeon to sew the left side of his face back on. The pain will no doubt subside, but the scars will last a lifetime, a permanent badge of courage. And every time Bridger looks in the mirror, he'll remember the day he stood in the gap for his sister. Later, when it was all over, his dad would ask him, "Why'd you do that, buddy?" And the response from this 6-year-old little boy is what makes this story so remarkable. He said, "Dad, if somebody had to die, I'd rather it be me." Real love, self-sacrificing love, shows up in the hard places, doesn't it? It manifests itself not just in words, but in action, and it showed up in that backyard in July in Cheyenne, Wyoming, and it showed up on that hill outside Jerusalem more than 2,000 years ago. Christ said, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends." We surround this table this morning because those words took the form of action. Because in the hardest of places, Jesus stepped in the gap for us. Your sins, my sins, sins of all mankind separated us from our God, a righteous God, a just God. And the only way that a sinful people could escape the wrath that we deserved was Jesus and the cross. You see, somebody had to die. And Jesus, through his actions on the cross, told us, "I'd rather it be me." Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we are humbled by this notion that you would love us enough to send your only Son in our stead. Father, it was us that was deserving of death, and you chose to sacrifice your Son instead. Father, we are mindful of that great sacrifice this morning as we surround this table, as we partake of this bread which represents his pierced body. We proclaim his death. Through Jesus we ask it. Amen. us continue our thanksgiving. Father, we're so thankful for this sacrifice, and we're especially thankful for the blood that was still spilled on our behalf on Calvary. We're thankful for the opportunity of second chances that are given to us through his blood and your grace. And, Father, we're thankful for this fruit of the vine, which helps us to remember that blood. We pray, Father, that you would help us to partake now in a way that honors and reveres you and your Son. It's through Jesus we ask it. Amen.
Thank you all for being here this morning. A quick reminder of Dave's class tonight, as well as after this song, I'm sure we'll have a little bit of information, prayer, and don't forget the offering, which will be part of the prayer. If you will, please stand with me as we sing this song together. Take my hand, precious Lord.
When my way groweth drear, precious Lord, linger near. When my life is almost gone, hear my cry, hear my call.
Just so good to see each and every one here today. Jonathan, thank you. Derek, thank you. David, thank you for your lesson. Through these difficult times and difficult days, it is so encouraging that the hope that regardless of what's happening, that God's Word gives us. He sustains us. He takes care of us. And we are so grateful for that. And above all, we worship Him. Again, so glad that you could be here. Let's remember those who cannot be here with us. As we exit, a reminder, we'll exit the back rows first and then up to the front. There is a tray on the table in the hallway that we can put our offering, and we will pray for that as we dismiss. A reminder, if you're able, and to supporting Grant County tonight at 6 o'clock p.m. That's all I have. Let's close with the prayer. Father God in heaven, Father, we praise your holy name. Thankful that we are able to be here this time of worship. Father, we're so thankful for Jesus. Thankful that he loved us so much that he gave his life, and thankful that he loved you so much that he obeyed your will and gave his life on the cross. No greater love has ever been shown than his love for us. Father, as we go out this week, Father, may we be an example to those around us. May we live faithfully. May we spend time dedicating to study of your word and to prayer, and to being the faithful follower that we need to be and the example to others. Father, we pray for our members who cannot be here. Father, we pray for them, those that are sick. Restore them health, Father, if it be your will. Be with those that have recently lost loved ones. Comfort them, Father, and be with us as we go into this week. Father, so thankful for our visitors that are here with us today. And Father, we're just thankful that we've been able to have this time of worship, Father. Watch us as we leave here. Please keep us safe. And we look forward to Wednesday night when we'll come back together again. And tonight, those that will be watching Dave's lesson and participating that way. Thankful for him doing that. Father, we love you and thank you for all your blessings. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.